What's better than one solid state drive? Five of them, of course. In this video, we're going to combine them in a setup known as RAID 0, which means every drive is used at once for both reading and writing data. Theoretically, this means the performance is multiplied by every drive. So with five drives, it should be five times faster than a single drive. We will reach that speed. That's what this video is about, of course. I've already made a video about trying out RAID 0 with SSDs on a Dell PowerEdge server. On that machine, the results weren't very impressive because its RAID controller from circa 2006 only supports the slower SATA 1 speed, but we did reach about 4 times that speed. So now I want to try RAID on this Fujitsu Esprimo, which is a newer machine that supports SATA 3 speed. It's not specifically for server use. And it has 5 SATA power connectors, so I can connect 5 drives instead of just 4. Its RAID controller is integrated in the motherboard instead of being on a separate card. Let's set it up now. Okay, so I have connected the 5 SSDs. To set them up on this computer, we go to the SATA configuration settings and switch from AHCI mode to RAID mode. That's simple enough. Here are the drives I managed to scrounge up. One is 240 gigabytes, one is 128, and the other ones are 120. The last SATA port is empty because there is no SATA power connector, so I couldn't add the 6th SSD. Now we have to restart, save changes and reset. Go back to the BIOS setup. And now there's a new option at the bottom, Intel Rapid Storage Technology. This allows us to set up the RAID. So now it says that array volume has failed, but that's just my previous attempt. I thought I had deleted it, but it must have stuck with some drives, so let's delete it for good. And now we can create a new RAID volume. We're gonna choose RAID 0 again, because we wanna do the fastest setup, not the safest one. See at the bottom it says select at least 2 disks. If we do 1, it only accepts 2 disks. If we do RAID 5, it accepts at least 3. If we do RAID 10, it only accepts 4. And the special recovery option might be to create backup drives, I'm not sure. Anyway, let's start with RAID 0. Select all the disks. Total capacity, just under 600 gigabytes. Strip size, it should show some help right there, but they forgot to write that. Off camera, I tried 32 and 128, and I didn't see much difference, so I'll just go with the default, which is 32. And capacity, we'll use everything that's available. Some space is wasted on the drives that are larger than 120 gigabytes, but this is just a test, so it doesn't matter. And let's create the volume. There we go, it's already done. It's ready and bootable. But all of this was done in EFI mode. If we go to the boot options, CSM configuration, you'll see that CSM is off, which means it's strictly using EFI mode, not legacy BIOS. But the operating systems I wanted to try are in legacy mode, so I'm gonna turn on CSM and set all of these options to legacy. Now let's restart. And we'll see something a bit different. This. So I've pressed Control I, and this is the same setup, but in legacy mode. It looks old-fashioned, obviously, but it's the same technology underneath. The volume is set up the same way, though, so we don't need to set it up again. So let's go ahead with the operating system setup. I've plugged in a USB flash drive. Now we can restart. First of all, there's Intel Volume 0, that's our new RAID setup, but first we'll boot to my USB flash drive. I've got Mentoy with several ISO files, and even though I don't want to install Windows 10 right away, I'll show you its setup to show how the drive appears to a Windows installer. And there's how our RAID setup appears, just one large drive with the size we specified. Let's also take a look at it under Linux. And here at the top there are the disks separately, but they are members of our RAID setup. And further in the list, there's the RAID array, 600 gigabytes apparently. It appears twice, but this one is 0 bytes, so probably a mistake for it to appear. But this is what we would use. I'm guessing modifying the disks individually would break the array. Now let's set up some operating systems for real. We're booting up to Macrium Reflect, a software to do system image backups. And we're going to restore a special backup. First of all, is it connected to my network? Yes, it is. Let's connect to my network share. This setup I had in my first video about this Fujitsu computer. 6 Windows versions, from XP to 11. Let's restore it to this special RAID setup and see how much faster it is. Select the RAID 0 volume, copy partitions, and let's go. This is over gigabit Ethernet, so it shouldn't take too long, but we'll see. It's done. It didn't take that long. Now I'm gonna call it a night, but we'll come back, start it up, and see how fast it is. Now, why are we getting an NTLDR error when it's using the Windows Boot Manager from newer versions? This needs troubleshooting, and I better do it off camera, otherwise I'll jinx it, even if things have already started going awry. Okay, so here's what I had to do. First of all, I booted back into the Macrium Reflect Rescue Disk and ran the Fix Windows Boot Problems tool. That detected all the operating systems and rebuilt the Windows Boot Manager. You can also see the computer is now connected to a 16:9 monitor, or television to be exact, but the computer is the same. But we're nowhere near out of the woods yet. The bootloader works now, but none of the operating systems booted up. Every single one crashed with the inaccessible boot device error. You might have read online about setting the SATA mode to AHCI and not to RAID. But that's not a possibility when we actually do have RAID. We need the specific storage driver for the operating system to successfully boot on this RAID array. Standard SATA drivers will not work. For older versions of Windows, you can probably slipstream the Intel Rapid Storage Technology driver to an installation disk, but that requires reinstalling Windows, and I'm too lazy to do that for this experiment. However, there is salvation on Windows 8 and newer. Just boot up in safe mode. That makes Windows redetect the type of drive, and those versions of Windows have a compatible driver included. I did try it on Windows 7 and older, it doesn't work. But after a quick trip to safe mode, Windows 8 and newer are now working. But now let's simplify things. I decided to delete this RAID array, set it up again in EFI mode, and do a clean installation of Windows 10 and drivers. We'll concentrate on testing speeds on that OS only. How fast is it? One SATA 3 SSD is around 500 megabytes per second. Will 5 of them reach NVMe SSD speed? Let's run a benchmark tool. Well, that's barely over twice as fast, not 5 times. Obviously, the way the drives interface with the rest of the computer has a certain limit. Still, this is the fastest drive setup I've ever used on a computer. The only device with NVMe storage that I have is my phone. All my computers have SATA or IDE. And a single SATA SSD is still fast enough in this decade. Even one without DRAM cache. Even though one with is better, of course. I backed up this clean installation. I restored it to just one SSD, no RAID. And I repeated the disk benchmark. Then I repeated it with 2 disks in RAID 0. Then 3, and 4. Here are the results. These two graphs show the same info, just organized differently. Let me know which graph you prefer. But yeah, the results are all over the place. It might have to do with the fact I'm using different brands and sizes of drives. RAID should ideally be used with identical disks, or at least identical capacity. However, the array with the most disks is the fastest one, mostly. So is this setup worth it? Definitely not when the improvement is this small. You want to know the difference in startup time? On the left is a single SSD, on the right is 5 in RAID 0. It's actually the same. Shocking, I know. And you're at the mercy of all of your drives. If a single drive fails in a RAID 0 setup, all of your data is gone, because a little bit of data is stored in every drive, and the missing parts cannot be retrieved because there's no recovery information, also known as parity data. For that, you have to use a different RAID setup, for example RAID 5, which is basically RAID 0 but with some protection. But I think we've seen enough in this video. I had to borrow some SSD from other people's computers, so I have to give them back. We're done with this experiment. Thank you for watching.